It's great to see you all. Please stand and worship with us as we direct our hearts to Jesus, our rock and our foundation.
Church, you can take a seat. We are going to go through a few announcements. First of all, my name is Luke, and welcome to the Bridge. I'm so glad that you're here. Whether you're here in person or you're watching online, thank you for coming. We're very, very glad that you're here. I'm going to go through a few announcements, all of which should be in the program. There's also available on our app and online, so if you are home, you can still take a look at it. First of which is the communication card, which is all done digitally, again, which is on our app or online, or you got the QR code in front. You can scan that, and that will bring you straight to the communication card. And all that is a little bit of information about yourself. And then on the back, there's actually a spot for prayer requests and comments, and we take those very seriously at the Bridge and pray for those on a weekly basis. So please take advantage of that and let us know how we can be praying for you in your life. So, first of all, in the insert here, there's a lot going on in the fall at the Bridge. So please take some time to read it all through. I'm not going to take time to go through everything, but I do want to point just a few things out. First thing is next week we are going to be introducing fall growth groups. And so we have growth groups at the Bridge, and those are small groups. It's a very great way to get to know people at the Bridge, to have a great sense of community and grow together in our knowledge and love for Christ. So we are going to be introducing those next week, and signups will begin then. Also, next week is Bridge Kids Move Up. So each of the kiddos will be moving up to the next grade for classes, and I believe there's also going to be a class for third and fifth grade. So please plan accordingly for that if you have kids in that age bracket. And then fantasy football. I'm already talking brackets. Sorry, everybody. And then also, just to put on your calendars, the weekend of September 25th and 26th is the Eau Claire Marathon, and we have historically done a water station, and we're going to do that again this year. And so the race is on Sunday, so we are going to move church to Saturday night. And that way we all have no excuse. We can all go and serve our community. And I joke, but this is actually a fantastic way that we can get in front of our community, help them, love them, and show them Christ's love by handing out water to people who are running and racing. So we are going to do that as a church, so please put that on your calendar. Again, there's a lot more going on that I'm not going to go through, so please take some time to read this. And I believe that is all I have for right now. So if you would stand with me, I will pray as we continue our service in worship. Lord God, we love you so much, and boy, it's just been a heavy couple weeks with everything going on over in Afghanistan. Lord, continual attacks over there. We've got a hurricane coming. It's going to be hitting our shores, and the no doubt devastation that that's going to bring. Lord, it seems like there's a lot happening, and we are getting hit from all different areas. We're being hit spiritually. And yet, Lord, I just think of David and how he was a man after your own heart, and he laid all of that out there. He laid out what he was going through in his sorrow and his troubles, but he always came back to you. And so, Lord, as we come possibly with heavy hearts, possibly with a lot going on in our own lives, and Lord, I just pray that we would be able to pause, lay that down at the foot of the cross, and come before you. Lord, David says in Psalm 71:14, "As for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more." And so, Lord, I just pray that over us today. I pray that we would cling to you, our hope, and Lord, that we would praise you more and more. Lord, we love you. Amen.
So, our God is a great God. He says in Malachi 1:11, "For from the rising of the sun to its setting, my name will be great among the nations, and in every place incense will be offered in my name, and a pure offering. For my name will be great among the nations, says the Lord of hosts." Let's worship him now.
Your breath in our lungs, so we As a church, The Bridge, we want to keep you encouraged to pray, and we're specifically praying, among other things, for a building for this body of believers located in Eau Claire to make their place, their central place, their operating place. And so this morning, in order to encourage you to pray, I have a story from the Old Testament, and it's a true story, as all the Bible stories are. It's in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, and we learn about this drama in Jerusalem where Jehoshaphat is the king, and to simplify things, we'll call him Josh. He hears that a mob of armed men from enemy countries are coming to attack his city, Jerusalem. And King Josh assembles the leaders of the country and their families, their children and their little ones, says the text. And they stand before the Lord while he leads in a prayer that ends like this. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. In other words, we have no power and we have no plan, but we're looking to you. Before the leaders and their children and grandchildren, King Josh acknowledges that if God does not help, he and his country will be totally overrun by this army. But although Josh is desperate, God is not. God says, don't be afraid. I've got this. This is my fight. I own these guys. So King Josh trusts God. And we know that he trusts because he sends the choir out in front of the army. The choir leads the army. And they're praising God. And they're singing this. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. God super confuses the enemy, and they fight each other until the whole army is destroyed. So as we and our families pray for a building, let's believe that God's got this. Let's pray praising him and showing our children, our families, his mighty work. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we have no power to compel a building to come on the market. We have only the barest of ideas for a plan, but our eyes are on you. We have a sense of urgency, but we don't think you have a sense of urgency. Everything that will happen to us will happen in your good time. So we wait and we watch with our families to see your great provision for our need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much, Grant. Appreciate the encouragement that is and the reminder that is about how God works. And, you know, the truth is, some of the things that's happening this week, you know, us finding a building is not the most important thing in the world, but we can trust God at the right time. He's gonna answer. Bridge kids, we're going to let you go and go to your classes. Thank you so much for joining us for worship today. And I think it's kind of exciting. Next week, we're adding the third grade and up back to our regular schedule. And I appreciate our Bridge Kids team leaders so much. They have helped us navigate through COVID, and it's just kind of an ongoing thing week by week. And I appreciate all that they do. So today, we continue with our series in Proverbs, and it's about wisdom, which is really the art of skillful living. And today we're going to learn from our words, because speech, we communicate with language, and we talk a lot sometimes, and it's really important, and we're going to focus on that today. Megan Phelps Roper grew up in a Kansas-based church, Westboro Baptist Church. There might be a few of you know about that church. It has an extensive reputation, and it's not always about representing Christ well. For Megan, it was normal for her to stand on picket lines with her church growing up. This was just how they did it. And they had a worldwide reputation for their radical approach in voicing their opinions. They have picketed funerals of fallen soldiers because of their stance on the war. They publicly have celebrated natural disasters and tragedies as judgment of God on wicked people. Growing up, Megan learned to hate gay people and transgender people and atheists and Jews and Mormons and Catholics and Muslims, as well as many Christian denominations. However, in 2012, she began to have a heart change, and it happened on Twitter. Who would have thought? She learned through Twitter, where she ranted her views week by week, and she would engage people to argue. Then some of the people she was engaged with on Twitter started coming to the picket lines to meet her and to talk with her. She began over time to see these people as just regular human beings. And it began to change her attitude and the way she talked. And the people treated her with kindness and dignity. And she knew she didn't really deserve it. She said it took time, but she began to doubt the very lifestyle she'd had embraced growing up. She decided, a very hard decision, she decided to leave her church, but she didn't leave Christianity. It meant leaving friends. It meant leaving family. She was ostracized, and it was a very hard thing to do. But she began to understand for the very first time, Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 1, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. It started to soak in. And when she reflected on her past involvement with Westboro Baptist Church, she wrote this. She said, "I remember this path. It will not take us to where we want to go. We have to talk and listen to people we disagree with. And I will always be inspired to do so by those people I encountered on Twitter. Apparent enemies who became my beloved friends. They came to me with pointed questions, tempered with kindness and humor. They approached me as a human being, and that was more transformative than two decades of outrage, disdain, and violence." That's a pretty amazing change. Question for us, have you learned that a gentle answer turns away wrath and that harsh words stir up anger? Megan Phelps Roper was learning wisdom, the art of skillful living. And that brings us to our first point this morning. Our words can hurt people or they can help people. Our words can help people or hurt people. So do you want your words to help others, or do you really want your words to hurt people? And you can say, well, it depends on who it is. Are you sure about that? Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 18, the writer says, "The words of the reckless pierce like swords, but the tongue of the wise brings healing." Reckless people, people who sometimes just spout off in anger. Sometimes they respond without thinking. They speak harsh words that cut to the quick, like daggers, like wounding with a sword. It's like gouging people with words. They cause pain and discouragement. the tongue of the wise, the speech of the wise, that it can bring healing. It can promote healing and recovery from hurt. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 4, the soothing tongue is a tree of life, but a perverse tongue crushes the spirit. Now, we talked about how Proverbs are written in a form of a parallelism where they have two ideas. Here's an example of an antithetical parallelism, meaning they're opposites. On the one hand, you have the soothing tongue. On the other hand, the perverse tongue. We have the ability to provide soothing speech, or we have the ability to crush someone's spirit. This is really powerful in our homes, in our marriages, in our parenting. We have the power to soothe and to bring healing. We also have the power to crush a spirit. And you know, that happens a lot in families, doesn't it? And sometimes people grow up in families where they're not encouraged and where they've sort of been criticized and shamed, and they really don't know how to encourage others. But, you know, as adults, we can learn. And, you know, we can start changing our speech patterns. In a 2016 research study, researchers found that when doctors spoke rudely to their medical team, now I know we have quite a few people in the medical community here at the Bridge, and I don't know if you found this to be true, but when doctors speak rudely, both accuracy and performance suffered significantly. Medical teams exposed to bad behavior and nasty comments demonstrated poor diagnostic and procedural performance compared to teams who weren't exposed to this incivility. Researchers wrote, simple rudeness has robust implications on medical team collaboration processes. Rudeness and lack of kindness undermine people's ability to think clearly and make good decisions. It steals confidence and weakens motivation. You know what? This is true in the family as well, isn't it? Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 21, the lips of the righteous nourish many, but fools die for lack of sense. Antithetical parallelism. We have a potential to nourish. Think about this. Think about the power of the tongue to promote life. We can even share the words of eternal life through our speech. We can add value to people's lives by what we say. And sometimes we just don't know how important it is. We just sort of think like, well, it's not that big a deal. It's really not going to make that much difference. You know, besides, you don't want to build up somebody too much, right? You don't want to, you know, overstate their who they are, what they've done. But we often don't know the impact of a compliment. In a study in the Psychology Bulletin, researchers asked people to approach a same-gender stranger, so men to men and women to women, and offer a sincere compliment. And people were really uncomfortable with this, to go up to a stranger and to compliment them about something. And they expected that their compliment would be received in a negative way. That's what they assumed, but they were wrong. They underestimated how flattered, how happy, and how pleased people were to receive a compliment. They overestimated how awkward or annoyed their recipients would feel. And one researcher wrote this, we should think about how we would feel with a compliment. A few kind words go a long way. Proverbs 16, verse 21. So we're just kind of doing a survey of wisdom in this series. I know we're covering a lot of scripture, but sometimes we just need to be reminded how much wisdom is in the book of Proverbs. 16:21, the wise in heart are called discerning, and the gracious their gracious words promote instruction. Wise people are discerning. Wise people are critical thinkers, but they are not critical people. Wise people use gracious words, kind words, words that cut people some slack, that are not judgmental. Sometimes we're afraid to be kind because we, again, this is pretty funny, but in our early marriage, you know, I grew up in, you know, it was all about football, and it was, you know, it was the Vince Lombardi area, era. Ron Kramer was a lineman for the Packers, and when he was a rookie, Vince Lombardi was just all over his case, just the first week, and he just criticized him for everything he did. And by then, Jerry Kramer was ready to quit. And so at the end of the first week, Lombardi comes up to Jerry Kramer with on the bench with his head down. He tousled his hair and said, "Someday, son, you're going to be the best lineman in the NFL." And he proved that in that time period. I grew up with that. Don't give out too many compliments, just once in a while. I tried that in marriage. It's true. I didn't want Sue to think, didn't want her to get a big head or anything like that. But I can learn. I can learn. Gracious words promote instruction. They provide role models. They make learning easier. I remember reading about a boy who was having trouble at school, and he was, you know, continually not following his teacher's instructions. And so the teacher got a hold of the parents and wanted them to come in to her office and to meet with her. And so parents came in, and the dad sat there with his arms crossed, and he said, "Well, what's wrong now?" And the teacher decided to give him a list of 10 positive things about their son. And they were just really surprised and taken back. And then the dad said, "Well, what else?" And she said, "That's it." And they were kind of flabbergasted. But they went home, and dad read the list to their son. And he was so surprised. But there a change began to take place in their son. And when he went to school the next day, he began to see himself differently. And he began to try to live out those positive things that his teacher had noticed about him. And it had a revolutionary effect on his life. Proverbs 18:8, the words of a gossip are like choice morsels. They go down to the inmost parts. The words of gossip are like choice morsels. You know, they can be attractive to us. They make us curious. We want to know more, but they affect our hearts. And that's what the writer of Proverbs wants us to know. It can influence what we think of other people. And it may bring us into passing gossip as well. And gossip impacts the heart. It goes down deep. Proverbs 27, verse 6, wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. Wounds from a friend. We don't like that, do we? Wounds from a friend is when sometimes, you know, and this is where words are appropriate sometimes to admonish one another. That's what the Bible says, that we can admonish one another in love, and it's out of relationship and out of friendship because we care about the well-being of that person and knowing that you're a Christ follower, and by sharing this, it's going to help you redirect and grow as a Christ follower if that's what's needed to take place. So at times, we may have friends speak the truth in love. They may offer insight and correction, and it may hurt at first. It feels like a wound. But if we pay attention, we can learn. Just because perhaps often they're right, because sometimes we have blind spots. The Bible just assumes there will be times when we need to admonish one another. And I'd have to say, this is a pretty significant weakness in the church today. People are often afraid to admonish one another out of love, to have the courage, because, oh, if I do that, they'll think, I think that I'm perfect and I got it all together. No, none of us. We're all sinners. None of us have it all together. But we can help each other. On the other hand, an enemy, someone who doesn't really care about us, they can be deceptive. And the writer says they multiply kisses. Well, I don't think we have too many guys multiplying kisses to other guys just out of the social setting. But the idea is that they're showing affection and they're deceitful. And it's not what they really think because they're doing a cover-up. They don't really care. So remember, our words have the power to help people or to hurt people. Secondly, our words must be guided by wisdom, the art of skillful living. Our words need to be guided. And we need to develop wisdom. We've talked about this week by week. The art of skillful living. It's about experience in life. You know, you don't just come into this world with all kinds of wisdom. You need some help along the way. It includes having a desire to walk with God, because remember, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. It's about taking God seriously. It's about learning God's word. It's about learning to apply God's word to our daily lives. And, you know, we just don't come with all that in place. It's a process. And we kind of invest a lifetime in it. We're all at different places. Proverbs 10, verse 19. Sin is not ended by the multiplying of words. People like to talk, don't they? Especially when they get into an argument. And multiplying words is just keeping it going and adding to it and proving all this information you have that you're right and they're wrong. And by the way, I have one more argument and I'm just going to nail you with it. Sin is not ended. In fact, sin can continue. I found myself at times, I appreciate Bible knowledge and have been blessed with my fair share along the way. But sometimes I've gotten into discourses with people and I just want to nail them with truth. You know, I just want to hammer them every verse I can think of to prove that they're wrong. That's not wise. Sometimes it just plain hurts. Sin is not ended by multiplying words, but the prudent hold their tongues. The prudent, and these are the wise, they learn that sometimes it's just best to hold your tongue. You don't have to have an answer for everything. Just because you can think of more things to say doesn't mean you should say it. Proverbs 11:12. Whoever derides their neighbor has no sense, but the one who has understanding holds their tongue. Whoever derides their neighbor, that's about putting neighbors down with humor. Webster says it means to make fun of, it means to laugh at or scorn or have contempt for or to jeer or to mock. And I think one of the things we have today in society that's classic is sarcasm. I have a lot of experience with sarcasm, too much experience with sarcasm, but you can say things sarcastically. Sometimes they're funny, and they're kind of two-ended. And when somebody is sarcastic, sometimes you're not sure which did they mean. Was that to hurt, or was that just funny, or what? And I used to like to do that because, you know, kind of cool, I thought. Whoever derides their neighbor has no sense. That's what God thought. Good humor doesn't hurt people. Sometimes it's better not to speak, even if you think you have a funny thing to say. Proverbs 16, verse 23, the hearts of the wise make their mouths prudent, and their lips promote instruction. Wise people are guarded by their hearts that are set on pleasing God. When they speak, they promote instruction, they promote good advice, and they promote learning. Proverbs 17, verses 27 and 28. Wise people, the one who has knowledge uses words with restraint. Whoever has understanding is even-tempered. And this is the kind of thing that comes with maturity. Uses words with restraint, is even-tempered. Doesn't mean you can't be a passionate person, but you don't always have to let your passion out all the time. They are not know-it-alls. Now, one of my favorite verses in Proverbs is verse 28. Even fools are thought wise if they kept silent, and discerning if they hold their tongues. And so sometimes I look smart because I don't say much sometimes. You can too. The danger is when we open our mouth and then people can see how foolish we are. Proverbs 18:6, the lips of fools bring them strife and their mouths invite a beating. Now, this can save our kids some heartache. And if kids can learn this along the way as they grow up and as they face peers, it can be quite helpful. Foolish people get into trouble with their words. Sometimes they feel like they just must speak out because they're right or they're totally just. But sometimes they get into situations where kids will beat them up because of their mouth. And maybe your kids won't run into that, but the sad thing is kids like that grow up to become adults. And they just want to spout off, and they don't care what other people think. And that's why we see a lot of bar fights and street fights, and alcohol just plays right into it as well. The lips of fools bring them strife, and their mouths invite a beating. It's pretty simple. You know, we can pass this on to our kids, and they can learn to read their culture with wisdom. Proverbs 20, verse 19, a gossip betrays confidence, so avoid anyone who talks too much. And some people just like to talk too much. They like to talk about others. And they might say, it's not harmful, it's just the truth. Kids need to learn that not everyone should be trusted. And sometimes adults need to learn again that not everybody should be trusted. Sometimes adults are pretty gullible in their relationships about thinking, this person, I can share my heart and I can tell all these things and, you know, they love me. I don't know, maybe they do, but soon they're passing on information that you thought was confidential. And, you know, our kids can learn that. And we need to know it as adults. So we find our words can help or hurt people. Our words must be guided by wisdom. Lastly, number three, our words will be accountable before God. We'll start with Proverbs 3, verses 33 and 34. The Lord's curse is on the house of the wicked, and it can be an eternal curse if nothing changes. It can be an eternal judgment. But he blesses the home of the righteous. That's so good to know, parents. God will bless the home of the righteous. He, that is God, mocks proud mockers, but shows favor to the humble and the oppressed. He mocks proud mockers, those who overestimate themselves pridefully and they make fun of others. But God shows favor to the humble and the oppressed. God has your back when you're humble. 1 Peter chapter 5, James chapter 4 said, God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. It's his favor on the humble. You know what? I want God on my side as much as possible. However, I'm not always humble. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 22, the Lord detests lying lips, but he delights in people who are trustworthy. He detests people who lie. He detests lies, but he delights in people who are trustworthy. People, to be trustworthy, you have to be truthful. You have to be honest. You have to be a person of integrity. You have to have faithfulness. Faithfulness is following through on the truth and your commitment to follow God. And these kind of people are people that you can trust. And God delights in people who are trustworthy. Question for us is that you? Are you a trustworthy person? You can teach that to your kids. Jesus reminds us about our speech in Matthew chapter 12 and verses 34 through 37. And Jesus says these words. He says, "For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of." What's down deep inside is the source of our speech. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him. A good man, a good woman, brings up good things from what's been stored up. It takes time. It's been stored. It's been embraced. It's been taken in. It's taking in wisdom. It's taking in God's word. It's living in a way of trusting God, storing up. It's not just an instant piece of information. A good man brings up good things out of the good stored up in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. So it's about the heart and what's stored, what is being stored in your heart. What are you filling your heart with? Because that's going to affect your speech, your thoughts. Next slide. Jesus said, "But I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned." That's pretty strong words. By your words, you could be condemned, because what we say is proof of what's in our heart. There are 72 different muscles that help produce speech. Did you know that? I bet we have one or two people in the room that know that. 72 different muscles. On the average day, we speak 16,000 words. But you have to average that for male and female. You know, men don't speak 16,000 words a day. And I remember early hearing more like a woman speaks about 30,000 words a day and the typical man about 5,000 words a day. That might be, at least you come up with an average. So in a lifetime, we speak about 860,300,000 words. And what will all these words and these verbs and these nouns and these adjectives and these sentences say about us? What will it say about the condition of our heart? And one day we're going to know. One day we'll stand before God and we're just going to know these things instantly. A prayer for us, and I want to close with this, is Psalm 19, verse 14. The psalmist writes, "May the words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer." The words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, my thought processes. What do I think about? Where does my mind go? What am I attracted to? It deeply affects the heart. And here's a prayer that God will help us with our words, that God will help us with our thought life, and may it be pleasing. Because it's easily distracted and it's easy to drift. And here's a prayer to come back to it. I want to start fresh. The words of my mouth, my thought life, the meditations of my heart, may they be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Let's stand for prayer. Our Father, today we've covered a lot of information in the Proverbs about wisdom and about the impact of our speech. May we continue to learn and to grow about wisdom and having the art of skillful living and learning about the impact of our words on others, how we can help or how we can hurt. May we continue to seek wisdom. And God, we just want to recognize that we know that one day we'll stand before you and we'll be accountable for our lives. One day we will come before the judgment seat of Christ. If we're Christ followers, if we're not Christ followers, it'll be the great white throne judgment. But we are all going to give an accountability for what we said, for our words. And Lord, give us a fresh start today with our words. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our heart be pleasing in your sight, O God. Help us to align with your Holy Spirit, and may we be empowered with his strength. For Jesus' sake and in his name I pray, amen.
Fail not as thou
I have a confession to make. I said last week that this was Labor Day weekend. I was wrong. And I said I was going to speak on Learn from the Lazy. Well, that's next week. So that we're going to talk about that next week from the book of Proverbs. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you for those who have joined us online. God bless you all. We're dismissed.